Mother's Day from the original Pentecostals. We just want to tell you that we are praying for you. We love you, all of our mothers. We hope you have a great day. And here are some mothers who want to share their greetings with you for a happy Mother's Day.
Hello, Mom. We just want to say happy Mother's Day. Thank you for everything that you do. We love and appreciate you. Happy Mother's Day, baby.
Oh, thank you, baby.
And to all the mothers at TOP, we love you. Have a blessed day. It's your day. And we love you and we miss you.
Happy Mother's Day!
Happy Mother's Day to the best mom ever. I am who I am because of you. I love you.
Okay, cool. This is Holy. Just wanted to let you know to have a great Mother's Day. Me and Aiden both wish you a really happy Mother's Day and we both love you so much. Bye.
Happy Mother's Day to all the mothers out there, especially my mom, my Filipino mom, and my wife. I love you guys all so much.
I love you, Mommy, because you make me almond butter sandwich.
I love you, Mom, because you keep me organized.
I love you, Mom, because you help me with my homework.
Happy Mother's Day!
I want to thank you, honey, for giving me five beautiful kids.
raising everyone with good Christian values and morals. Thank you.
Thank you, Mom, for always taking care of us and being there when we need you.
Thank you, Mom, for teaching us so many things.
Thank you, Mom, for being there to talk with us when we need you.
And thank you for being so kind and sweet to me.
We love you, Mom! Happy Mother's Day!
Hey, we just want to say Happy Mother's Day to all the mothers out there. We hope that your day is blessed and we love you.
Happy Mother's Day!
Hi, Mom. I wanted to say Happy Mother's Day and I love you and thank you so much for everything that you have done for me and everything that you continue to do and help me with. You are the perfect example of a selfless and giving and caring mom, and you've taught me that a mother's love truly is unconditional and it doesn't stop. Your job and your work continues no matter how grown or how old your kids might be, and I hope to one day be half of the mother that you are. Thank you so much for showing me that. I love you. Maraming salamat at mahal na mahal ko kayo.
I love you, Nana, because you make good dinner.
I love you, Nana, because you make the best breakfast.
I love you, Nana, because you let us sleep over.
Happy Mother's Day!
Hi, Lola. Happy Mother's Day from me and Aiden both. We just wanted to wish you a Happy Mother's Day. Love you!
Happy Mother's Day, Mom. I just wanted to say, get on here and say Happy Mother's Day. I'm so thankful for you, and I'm so thankful that I have you as an example of how to be a mom when I become a mom, and of what to do when I'm a wife. You know, that all fits in there. I'm pretty sure I have the best mom out there all around. I love you so much, and I'm so thankful for you. As of the other moms of TOP, Happy Mother's Day, y'all, and I hope you have a good one. Goodbye.
Aiden. Can you give Mommy a kiss for Mother's Day?
Ma. 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 Ma.
Of their sins just disappear. For anyone who's ever felt the hand of heaven reach down through their fear and dry their tears. For any life once empty that now finds itself alive and full of songs, victory songs, then you'll understand the reason for the way the saints of God may carry on.
So when I shout, know I'm shouting from a heart that's been washed clean. When I run, know I'm running from a past that's been redeemed. To the world, it might look crazy. There's just no telling what you're going to do. Jesus gets a hold of you.
Thank you, Jesus. For anyone who's ever seen the mountain of their sins just disappear. For anyone who's ever felt the hand of heaven reach down through their their tears. For any life once empty that now finds itself alive and full of songs, victory songs, then you'll understand the reason for the way the saints of God may carry on.
So when I shout, know I'm shouting from a heart that's been washed clean. When I run, know I'm running from a path that's been redeemed. To the world. world, it might look crazy. There's just no telling what you're gonna do. In that moment, Jesus gets a hold of you. So when I shout, no, I'm shouting from a heart that's been washed clean. When I run, no, I'm running from the past that's been redeemed. To the world, it might look crazy. There's just no telling what you're gonna do.
In that moment,
Jesus gets a hold of you.
For anyone who knows the hope that keeps them moving on through troubled days. For anyone who knows they've got a future and a hope beyond the grave. How he led us out of darkness into light. There's no way that I'll keep silent. Every breath's another chance to testify.
So when I shout, no, I'm shouting from a heart that's been washed clean. When I run, no, I'm running from a past that's been redeemed. To the world, it might look crazy. There's just no telling what you're gonna do. In that moment, Jesus gets a hold of you. So when I shout, no, I'm shouting from a heart that's been washed clean. When I run, no, I'm running from a past that's been redeemed. To the world, it might look crazy. There's just no telling what you're gonna do.
In that moment,
Jesus gets a hold of you.
For anyone who knows the hope that keeps them moving on through troubled days. For anyone who knows they've got a future and a hope beyond the grave. A different story, how he led us out of darkness into light. There's no way to keep us silent. Every breath's another chance to testify.
So when I shout, no, I'm shouting from a heart that's been washed clean. When I run, no, I'm running from a past that's been redeemed. To the world, it might look crazy. There's just no telling what you're gonna do. In that moment, Jesus gets a hold of you.
My past erased,
my name he changed, let's testify. My past erased, my name.
Do you have a testimony?
My past erased, my name he changed, let's testify.
Come on and testify.
My past erased, my name he changed, let's testify.
Oh, 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 tell somebody.
My past erased, my name he changed, let's testify. From a heart that's been washed clean. When I run, no, I'm running from a past that's been redeemed. To the world, it might look crazy. There's just no telling what you're gonna do.
In that moment,
Jesus gets a hold of you. So when I shout, no, I'm shouting from a heart that's been washed clean. When I run, no, I'm running from a past that's been redeemed. To the world, it might look crazy. There's just no telling what you're gonna do. In that moment, Jesus gets a hold of you.
Hallelujah. You are worthy, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Welcome to the Original Pentecostals. We are glad you are here with us today. We are excited to be in worship with you. There's no better place to be than to be in worship with the people of God. I am so excited that you are here with us. Thank you. I welcome you. Before we proceed, I'd like to have some announcements for you guys. Please keep in the back of your mind or the forefront of your mind if you want to. Every Wednesday at 7:30 p.m., we do have our online Bible study. Tune in, set a reminder on your phone, whatever you need to do. Go on Facebook, go on YouTube, allow the notifications. You want to be there when we start our online Bible study this week. It is going to be so exciting. It's going to be a fresh, challenging word of God directly for you and directly for your life. And we are so excited. Please go online, check out our Facebook, our Instagram, our Twitter, everything we're on. Go online, check it out. Make sure you're staying up to date with everything we have going on. Send somebody a message. Tell them you love them. Give us a thumbs up. Turn the blue button green. Everything that YouTubers say now, do all of that to us because we want to make sure you're connected with us. Have a couple of prayer requests before you guys this morning. Keep in mind everything that we've been praying for the past weeks. Those that are battling sickness, those that need protection over their work. If you have a prayer request, if you have a need, drop a comment, send us a message, whatever it is you want to do. Let us get you put on our prayer list so we can all be praying as a unified body specifically for you. We want to pray for you. We want to pray with you. So let's go ahead and pray today. Lord, I thank you, Jesus. I worship you, Lord. You are worthy, God. I thank you, Lord. I pray in the name of Jesus that you would touch every single one of these needs, God. Lord, that you would touch everybody that is watching this service, Lord. That you would let your spirit fill their room. Let it fill their house or their car or wherever they're watching, Lord. Let them feel you, God. Let them feel your spirit. Let them feel your presence, Jesus. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Lord, I pray for the Parkinson's, Lord, that you would touch them, Jesus. Keep your hand upon them, oh God. Lord, I pray for the Daltons, Lord, that you would keep them protected. Lord, I thank you, Jesus. I worship you, Jesus. You are worthy, God. I thank you, Lord. I thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, we worship and magnify you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. One thing that's kind of been running through my mind over the past couple months before we even had to start adjusting to the new way of life that we have now, it was this song. And it talks about, the chorus says, I am not enough unless you come. Will you meet me here again? And I just started thinking about that. And I was like, you know what, God? I was like, I'm not enough. I can't even begin to comprehend how little I am when it comes to you. And I was praying and the Lord was really moving and I was just so deep in the spirit and I just started praying, God, it's not about the blessings. God, it's not about whether or not I go to work tomorrow. It's not about any of that. It's about you. God, I am not enough. I don't care if I have anything else, but I can't go without you. I can't go another minute without feeling your presence. I can't go another day without hearing a fresh word from you because I am not enough. But the wonderful thing about the Lord is when you want him, when you need him, and when you call out to him, he is there in a heartbeat for you. He'll never even leave you. It doesn't matter if you feel alone or if you feel worried or abandoned. He's still right behind you. All you got to do is turn around. Keep that in your mind today as we sing the song. Worship with us. Let the Lord speak to you.
It can't go back to the beginning. I can't control what tomorrow will bring. But I know here in the middle is the place where you promised to be. Thank you, Jesus. I'm not enough unless you come. Will you meet me here again? 'Cause all I want is all you are. Will you meet me here again?
Let's sing that first verse one more time. Thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Jesus. I can't go back to the beginning. I can't control what tomorrow will bring. But I know here in the middle is the place where you promised to be. Thank you, Jesus. I'm not enough unless you come. Will you meet me here again? 'Cause all I want. Cause all I want is all you are. Will you meet me here again? Hallelujah. We thank you, Jesus. Lord, will you meet us here? Thank you, Jesus. Oh, solo robo koyana. Gonna let your love
rise above every fear, like the sun shaping the shadow. In my weakness, your glory appears.
Come on, sing, I'm not enough.
Not enough unless you come. Will you meet me here again? 'Cause all I want is all you are. Will you meet me here again?
I'm not enough. Oh, saying I'm not enough.
The Lord has moved upon me heavily for today, and I am stirred, and I guess that's not a rare thing, but I am very stirred today and very moved. I'm going to probably be very passionate because I feel like that the Lord has moved upon me. If we're not careful, we will miss we will miss what the Lord is trying to help us see. The scriptures are full of moments where God tried to get the attention of his people and of the world. He tries to get their attention as well. I have quite a host of scriptures to bring. I need to read at least one here before we pray. I'm going to read a scripture out of Matthew 24. Matthew 24, verse 32. I hope you have your Bibles with you. And I'm sure you have them in the house somewhere. Matthew 24, verse 32 says, "Now learn a parable of the fig tree. When his branch is yet tender and putteth forth leaves, ye know that summer is nigh." Next verse, 33, "So likewise ye, when ye shall see all these things, know that it is near, even at the doors." Let's pray together. Lord, we love you. We thank you for your word. And we ask that your voice would be heard this day. Ask that you would minister to all that hear, to all that have joined with this moment with us. I pray, Lord, that you would talk to us. Give us understanding and revelation. Give us the understanding that you are wanting us to be aware of the times that we are living in, and that our time is short. Pray your hand would be upon us all. We give you all the glory and all the praise and all the honor. We ask these things in the lovely name of Jesus. And wherever you're at, if you would say amen, amen. God bless you. You may be seated if you're standing. There's a plague in a in the world, and I know particularly in America, and I'm not talking about COVID-19, it's something that a lot of our children are dealing with, and now they're discovering that adults have a lot of this and a lot of issues with this, and it's called attention deficit disorder. We've teased about it, but it's a real issue. I looked up the symptoms of this inattention. I remember my dad would say, I'm going to get your attention when I would be getting in trouble. And basically he was saying, you need to pay attention to what I'm telling you. And of course he had his ways, and back in the old school times, it was go get a switch or, go get a paddle, or he's fixing to get your attention. But some of the symptoms of this inattention today they are finding is that a person often makes careless mistakes and lacks attention to details. These are things you can look up online and you can get. I've easily found this today. Examples of this are overlooking or missing details, or handling in work that is inaccurate. And I've noticed that, even sometimes I do not like to read the small print, but man, a lot of times there are details in the small print that you need to pay attention to. They say they often have difficulty paying attention to tasks. Example, someone might have difficulty remaining focused during a lecture or during a conversation or lengthy readings. They say they often seem to not listen when spoken to directly. I don't know, maybe we all have some of this going on in us. It seems like that the person's mind might seem elsewhere, or even in the absence of an obvious distraction, they're just not noticing it. They're not paying attention to it. I don't know if you've noticed it. I know with small kids anymore, it really is hard to get their attention. They've got their mind focused on so much other stuff. Often fails to follow through on instructions or chores or duties in the workplace. An example, somebody might start a task but quickly lose focus and get sidetracked and start another task or get involved with something else. And these are symptoms of this inattention. And then often has difficulty organizing tasks and activities. And some of the examples might be messy or disorganized work. And God forbid that you would look at my desk at home. Poor time management, or fails to meet deadlines, or never on time. Often avoids or dislikes or is reluctant to participate in tasks that require sustained mental effort, like preparing reports or completing forms or reviewing lengthy papers. They often lose things like tools or wallets or keys or paperwork or eyeglasses or mobile phones. My God. They might as well have my picture in here, it seems like. And I think some of that is old age in me. Often easily distracted by other things, including unrelated thoughts. It's amazing how easy it is to have your thoughts drift onto something else. I really believe that a lot of this is the result of us just having so much going on at once in our life. And certainly the scripture talks about the time when in the future when men would be running to and fro and just busy, 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 busy. It's like everybody's busy. And often forgetful in daily activities such as running errands or returning calls or even paying bills and keeping appointments. I just know that this is, many of you are going to say, my goodness, that is, it sounds like me. And then there will be a few of you that say, no, that's not me. But I believe that God is attempting to get our attention, to get our focus. I don't believe it's just a recent phenomena that God would try to do this. As I began to look in Scripture, I noticed there was quite a bit of occasion where God would just try to shake someone and get their attention and get their focus, because he wanted man to understand that he has a mission and he has a desire, he has a plan in place for things to happen the way he wants them to happen. And they're going to happen with or without us, but he wants it to happen with us. He uses men and women in his plan. I know even in the garden, I can just hear him saying, Adam, where are you? What happened? It seemed like just yesterday I had your attention, but now you're hiding. You're disappeared. You're off the map. And where are you? One story in Scripture that really, really got my attention was Jonah. Where do you think you're going, Jonah? I have a mission for you. The revival in the city of Nineveh was enough for God to rock Jonah's world, to shake him. I believe the story was true. The Lord prepared a whale, a large fish, to get Jonah's attention and to get him on track, because God had a plan for a revival in a city that was lost and had lost direction and was evil and was messed up. And God rocked Jonah's world over one city. I believe that he is rocking the whole world right now. And every church and every preacher, every child of God, because what he is up to is greater than we imagined. The revival that is headed our way is beyond our wildest dreams. That's God's shaking of the world. He has a mission for us. Forgive me for my passion, but we must get this. We must recognize this for what it is. Nothing happens in the world at this level without God being in the midst of it. And then there was the story of Moses, who was keeping the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. And he led the flock to the backside of the desert, came to the mountain of God, even to Horeb. And in Exodus chapter 3, verse 2, even though we could see the handiwork in Moses' life from the very beginning, from the salvation of him being in the bulrushes and God orchestrating his plan in Moses' life, there came a moment in Exodus chapter 3, verse 2, where the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. And he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed. And Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush is not burnt. And the Bible says, and when the Lord saw that he turned aside to see, when the Lord saw that he had Moses' attention, he recognized, all right, I set this thing on fire so that I could get your attention. I'm telling you, he set the world on fire right now to get our attention. And we have turned aside. I pray you have turned aside to see what God is up to. And it was in that moment that God made his plan very clear for Moses. He said, listen, Moses, you need to take your shoes off, for the ground whereon you stand is holy ground. I am God, and I am the God of your fathers, and I have come. I've got a plan. I've heard the cry of my people, and I've got a revival for the land of Israel, for the children of God. I've got a plan for them, and I want you to orchestrate it. He caused that fire and that burning bush, the miracle sight that no one had ever seen anything alike before. And I am telling you, God shook Moses' life when he got his attention. He got his focus. What does he have to do to get your attention? What does he have to do to get our attention? Everything, whether you like it or not, is about God's purpose. It's not about our purpose. The church is about God's purpose. It's not about our purpose. It's not about our little lives. He does care for us. And he is trying to take care of us, and he will. And he will make provision for us. He always had. But he's always been trying to get a hold of our attention. And now, unlike ever before, he is shaking the world to get the church's attention. In Matthew chapter 24, I read in your hearing, I pulled a scripture out of that passage, and I do not have time to read this entire chapter, but let me just skim the surface here. I want you to catch something. And as he sat on the Mount of Olives in verse 3, the disciples came unto him privately, saying, tell us, when shall these things be, and what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world? And in verse 4, Jesus answered and said, take heed that no man deceive you. And ye shall, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. And ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that ye be not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines and pestilences and earthquakes in divers places. And these are the beginning of sorrows. Verse 14, and the gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations. And then shall the end come. While all of the trouble is taking place, the gospel is still going to be preached by a church that is aware of where it's at and understands the plan of God and the purpose of God. And in verse 21, for then shall be great tribulation, such as was not since the beginning of the world to this time, nor shall there ever be. And except those days should be shortened, there should no flesh be saved, but for the elect's sake shall those days be shortened. In verse 24, for there shall arise false Christs and false prophets, and shall show great signs and wonders, insomuch that if it were possible, they should deceive the very elect. He's kind of repeating some of the things he said early in the chapter. And he says, listen, in verse 26, wherefore, if they shall say unto you, behold, he is in the desert, go not forth. Behold, he is in a secret chambers. Don't believe it. Believe it not, because here's how I'm coming. For as the lightning cometh out of the east and shineth even unto the west, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. He's giving us truth and revelation and understanding. That's how he's going to return, and it's going to be quick, and it's going to be like lightning. And that's how he's going to come. And then in verse 29, and immediately after the tribulation of those days shall the sun be darkened, the moon shall not give her light, and the stars shall fall from heaven, and the powers of the heavens shall be shaken. And then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven. And then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn, and they shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. And he shall send his angels with a great sound of a trumpet, and they shall gather together his elect from the four winds and from one end of heaven to the other. And then the scripture that I read in your hearing, and this is where I want you to get caught up. I want you to focus with me for just a moment. Now learn a parable of the fig tree. When his branch is tender and putteth forth leaves, ye know that summer is nigh. Catch some wisdom here. So likewise, ye, when ye shall see all these things, know that it is near, even at the door. And then in verse 36, but of that day and hour knoweth no man, no, not even the angels of heaven, but my Father only. Verse 37, but as the days of Noah were, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. For as in the days that were before the flood, they were eating and they were drinking, marrying and given in marriage, until the day that Noah entered into the ark. And these next three words blow my mind. It just puzzles me. And knew not. 100 years of preaching in a relatively small world. 100 years of preaching. And a man building a boat when there hadn't been a drop of rain. But nobody paid attention. Nobody listened. Nobody anywhere even thought twice about what was taking place. Oh, but not until the flood came and took them all away. And then he says, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. They're not going to know. They're not going to be paying attention. There are even going to be those in the church that aren't watching, that aren't ready. And I know I'm getting out of the camera. Sorry, I said I'd stay behind this pulpit. But let me tell you, I am so impassioned and feeling so much the Word of God here. I believe that God is in this Word. We need to be caught up in what God is up to. We need to be focused on what He is doing more than we ever have in our life. I believe we are coming to the time when God is going to reveal Himself, and He's going to come back in the clouds of glory. There's lots of things about to happen, and God is trying to get our attention. He's trying to wake us up. He says, then shall two be in the field, and one shall be taken, and the other left. Two women shall be grinding in the mill, and one shall be taken, the other left. Watch, therefore, for you know not what hour your Lord doth come. And he says this, but know this, that if the good men of the house had known in what watch the thief would come, he would have watched and would not have suffered his house to be broken up. Therefore, be ye also ready, for in such an hour as ye think not, the Son of Man cometh. We got too many people thinking not. They're not caught up in what the Lord is up to. They're focused on the trouble and the issues in their lives, not recognizing that God is shaking the earth. He is shaking the earth. and saying, look up, for your redemption draweth nigh. And I also believe that time is running out and that time is short. And it is the last day revival that God is trying to bring to us. He is getting the world's attention. But while the world is waking up, I'm scared to death that the church is still asleep. We need to recognize that this good book lets us know that in the last hour, there's going to be epic revival. But I only believe it's coming to those who are awake and ready and recognize where they're at. Joel 2:23. Be glad then, ye children of Zion, and rejoice in the Lord your God. For he hath given you the former rain moderately, and he will cause to come down for you the rain, the former rain, and the latter rain. There is a double portion revival that I believe is at the door for the church that is awake and aware and alive and ready and sees what God is up to and is caught up in prayer and searching out God and seeking his face. The Old Testament prophets promise a double portion harvest to the last day church, which will more than compensate for the dark ages that this world has come through. He says, and the floors shall be full of wheat, and the vats shall overflow with wine and oil. And I will restore to you the years that the locust hath eaten, the cankerworm and the caterpillar and the palmer worm, my great army which I sent among you. He sends the trouble to get our attention. And then in Amos, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that the plowman shall overtake the reaper, and the treader of grapes him that soweth seed, and the mountains shall drop sweet wine, and all the hills shall melt. I am telling you, we are in a moment and a season and a time when God is bringing forth and bringing to us a revival of epic proportions that is going to be the most incredible thing that we have ever seen in our lives. I am telling you, God is waking the world up. Church, we need to wake up. We need to be among the wise. I believe the call of the bridegroom is upon us. In reading that story I was sharing with someone before service today, that the call of the bridegroom goes out at midnight. The bridegroom cometh. And the Bible depicts the 10 virgins, every one of them being asleep at the wheel. They are slumbering and sleeping. But when the call goes forth, they wake up, but half are ready for about what's to happen, and half are not ready. And while they fumble around and try to get ready, they end up not being able to make it to the wedding. I want to be ready. How about you? How about you, church? Are we going to be ready for this epic revival and this last day outpouring? God's going to bring it to pass, but it's going to be for the church that is ready, awake, watching, and on their feet. Amen. And tapped in to what he is doing. Forgive me, but I could not get caught up in the NFL draft this last week. I'm sorry. Something in me is telling me I don't need to be interested in that. God has wiped all of that stuff out of our minds and out of our hearts for a season. And some of us are too quick to pick it back up, are too quick to start getting entangled again in the affairs of this life. And not going to be, we're just not going to be the soldier that God has called us to be if we get caught up in all of that stuff again. It's not the will of God. There's too many souls at risk. If God would develop a whale and set Jonah up to where he gets swallowed for a few days and spit up on the shores of Nineveh over one city, think what he is willing to do to this world to get our attention for the worldwide revival that he's bringing. That's why he's shaking us all. He's shaking us to our core, and he's shaking the world, and he's bringing about a harvest that's about to take place that we have preached about and prayed about and dreamed about and seen visions about for decades and decades. And it is upon us. And some of us are asleep. Some of us have an extreme attention deficit disorder. We're so easily distracted. So easily caught up. We're supposed to be looking here, and we're looking over here, and we're looking over there. And he said, look up. We need to be looking up for our redemption. It's nigh. It's close. The trumpet's about to sound. There's issues coming to our world. There's trouble coming our way. We've got to be connected to the Lord Jesus like never before. He is saying to the church, may I have your attention, please? May I have your attention, please? He bought us. He washed us in his blood. He filled us with his spirit. And even with all that, we get caught up in everything but what he's doing. He came, suffered, died, bled, was whipped, humiliated, so that we could be part of this marching army that he called the church. And then we sleep. God help us. God help us to be aware of what God is up to. I knew right away in the Holy Ghost, and it has been confirmed among many of my elders and ministers that I rub shoulders with. This trouble was a trial run of trouble. This was a wake-up call to the church that I believe is saying there's more trouble coming, but there's more revival coming. It's going to come together. It's going to come together. There is going to be a shaking, and there is going to be a revival. And God's Spirit is going to flow, and it's going to flow from the mountaintops, and it's going to flood our cities. And for the church that is ready to leap into action and be ready for this harvest, it is going to be epic. But there are going to be those who sleep through this and do not see it coming. And they're going to miss the action. And they're going to miss the outpouring. And they're going to miss the blessing. And I'm asking you, saint of God, don't let it be you. But it's a wake-up call. It's a time. It's a time to wake up. It's a time to wake up. I would that we would pray in every living room. I would pray right now, Lord Jesus, that you would touch every heart, every man, woman, boy, and girl that this word has gone into, every home that this has gone into, every situation, Lord, every phone, every iPad, every computer that this has come across. I pray, oh Lord, that your conviction that has been upon me since the hours of last evening as I began to feel you push us in this direction. I pray, God, that it pulls and tugs upon every heart, every mind, and every spirit. Lord, as the world tries to get back to normal, oh God, don't let us ever go back to that kind of normalcy. But let us be tapped in to what you are up to and to what your voice is saying. Let us hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Let us hear what you're speaking to your people. Let us be aware that this is the finest hour of the church. This is the greatest hour that we've come to. Yes, it's going to be a defining moment. It is going to be a challenging time. Matthew 24 tells us there's going to be trouble like the world has never seen. But it also lets us know the Word of God is true and that God's elect are going to be taken care of. He's going to even shorten the days so that we're okay. God's going to preserve and protect us and help us to see His work get done. I want to be a part of it. God bless you. I love you. I love you all. I pray something has moved in your spirit today.